Do you care about JSON? In this case, you should watch today's episode because we will talk about our new System.Text.Json API in .NET Core 3.0. Welcome to On.NET. My name is Immo Landworth. I'm a program manager on the .NET platform team. And with me today is...
My name is Ahson Khan, and I am a .NET developer on the .NET Core BCL team.
That's awesome. What is the BCL?
So BCL is the built-in base class library that comes with the .NET framework that when you install it.
That sounds cool. I think I've used that before at some point. So what do you want to talk about today?
So I want to talk about today the JSON library that we have been working on for the last 6 months or a year, that's coming in as part of .NET Core 3.0. So it's built in as part of .NET Core 3.0, so you don't have to worry about adding an additional package reference or any other dependencies.
So when you say JSON library, what does it roughly mean? What do we cover? Like, what features do we offer?
So for the JSON library that we have, we are covering MVP effectively. We have the JSON serializer, deserializer, JSON document, so you can have random access and query APIs, and the low-level APIs, reader and writer.
That's awesome. When you say MVP, you mean like a minimum viable product?
That's right.
Yes. So
we wanted to scope down and get the most commonly used scenarios working. Mm-hmm. And we want to make sure that the feature set is tenable.
Makes sense. And so when we talk about JSON, we cannot really not talk about JSON.NET, right? Which is the library that pretty much everybody who's ever done JSON in .NET has been using. So how is the library that we are building different from JSON.NET?
So the main difference is that we emphasize performance from the ground up. Mm-hmm. And we wanted to leverage the new APIs that have come up in .NET Core, specifically Span and Read-Only Sequence. Mm-hmm. So we wanted to make sure that the APIs are focused on high performance, low memory footprint, and also natively support UTF-8. Mm-hmm. The web traffic is usually in UTF-8 encoded, right. And James's library natively works on strings, mm-hmm. and in .NET, strings means UTF-16.
Right.
So that's the primary difference.
So basically, by supporting native UTF-8, we basically avoid the transcoding and the memory allocations of just transcoding it from one to the other just to parse some JSON. Right,
exactly.
That makes sense. So you wanted to show us something that, like, how can I observe, basically, the new JSON library in the context of .NET Core?
So from the most high level, right, if you have an ASP.NET app, effectively, you will see this work under the covers. So what I have here is REST API. This is the template API that you get when you do .NET new. And if you have a REST endpoint, you have a GET request, then under the covers, we are serializing using the new JSON library.
Right.
So before .NET Core 3.0, the default was just new sub-JSON,
yep.
And now the default is our library. So just by agreeing to .NET Core, ASP.NET Core 3.0, you would get that behavior. So I can show you an example. If I were to just run this web API and query the endpoint, this JSON payload is coming from, it's generated from the library, our library.
So basically, our library takes this instance of the weather controller, whatever this type is,
yep.
And it just serializes that into JSON.NET.
That's right. So I just create a dummy object, and if you can see, the values are showing up here. Now, if you wanted to revert back to JSON.NET, especially because there's some of the features that you might heavily rely on, for example, in this case, if this was a field rather than a property, mm-hmm. Our library does not support fields today. So
I think you're missing a semicolon now.
Yep, good point. And if I were to recompile or rerun, you would see most likely the temperature will no longer show up. So if you saw previously we had the temperature and now we don't because we changed temperature to be a field. But so let's say your model did have a field. The way you would opt into it is we have this integration package called Microsoft ASP.NET Core MVC new sub-JSON. Mm-hmm. You add a package reference to that. And on startup, the thing you want to just do is in your service connections, add new sub-JSON. And once you have that, you should be able to get back to the JSON.NET behavior. If If you could just get back to JSON-oriented behavior and leverage any of the features that you might want to use that are missing in the MVP that we have. So temperature's back.
Yeah, so is the goal that we have to have basic parity with JSON.NET for all features, or will there be a different feature set?
So the goal was never to have parity with JSON.NET, especially for some of the features that we don't think make sense as a built-in default, for example. For some of the other features, maybe like field support, we would imagine getting them in the future.
Right. So part of the reason why we shipped the preview is to get people to actually use the preview and actually serialize their own types, to actually see what features people actually depend on in practice, so we
That's
can
right.
prioritize work accordingly. Right. Of course, you have opinions on what we think many people are doing,
right.
but it's very hard to get data on, for example, do people use fields versus properties very often?
Right?
Like that's very hard for us to find that out.
Yeah, so that's what I'm actually really interested in as well. When people start using ASP.NET Core, the latest ASP.NET Core, see what breaks,
right?
And what doesn't work as they were expected. Getting their feedback would be super useful. Now going down the stack and actually diving into the APIs themselves, I have a few demos for Serializer and then all the way down to the low-level reader-writer APIs, which I want to showcase. So in the case of your Serializer, I have this account type. It has email, it has a date, and you have some roles. And what I've done is create this object, filled in some values, you have some date, you have roles.
Right.
And the most common scenario people have is serialize my type. All right. And the code that you have to write is you have this JSON serializer type within the System.Text.JSON and System.Text.JSON serialization namespaces. You include those in your project. And you can call toString and pass in the account. Now, if you were to run that, you should see the account payload show up. And this isn't really that human readable. So let's try to make it indented. And the way we do it is if you just initialize a JSON serializer options and pass that in. And we have the capability to add indented. And that should, if you just place that, that should be more human readable. Now, of course, for passing in data on the web, you want it to be as compressed as possible, so you probably don't necessarily care about human readability when you're doing perfectly scenarios. On the flip side, we have deserialization, and that's, it works the same. Similarly, we have parse APIs on the serializer, and we have JSON serializer.parse. And let's add a trailing comma just for the sake of it, and you can pass in an option, allow trailing commas true, to support that as well. And in that case, there you go. There's your email from your account object that we serialized.
That's awesome. So basically, that means almost all JSON pilots should be able to parse of our JSON library, right? I think commas is not standards compliance, whatever that means, but like it's very common people want to do that.
That's right. So some of the things we added because we observed people having them a lot in their payloads is trailing commas and comments. By default, we don't support either of those because by default we want to be RFC compliant.
Right.
And that's also a requirement that people have. They want to be able to validate that my incoming JSON is invalid and I truly want to throw. So we didn't want to enable those behaviors by default.
That makes sense.
Now onto the JSON document feature where we have, which allows building up a structured .NET type that represents the JSON payload. And in my example, I have this input JSON. It's effectively a list of students inside a class and their grades. And what I want to do is average out their grades. So we read the JSON from the file. And what I want to do is now create this JSON document that we have. The way I've done it is we call JSON document.parse, pass in this JSON string. And in this case, if you notice, again, we have trailing commas, even though we shouldn't. And you can pass in the reader options to the document as well. And the interesting thing about this is building an in-memory database or in-memory view of the JSON payload. So it has zero allocations, especially for relatively small payloads.
Let's sing in for a moment, because basically, when you say JSON document, to me, the equivalent is like an XML document or a Roslyn syntax tree, which by definition means it's a tree structure that has, you have a parent node, you have children nodes, and there's collections involved. So how do you not have any allocations in this?
So I mean, that's part of the trade-off we made here, which is we wanted to create a condensed view of the JSON and emphasize on how can we represent the JSON payload without allocation, but still be able to have reasonably performant query APIs. Mm-hmm. And the thing we have realized is usually objects in JSON don't have a lot of, the JSON itself could be large, but they themselves don't have enough, that many children. Mm-hmm. So if we optimize for parsing, but not for lookup, mm-hmm. then we can get this type of behavior. And so the side effect of this is the document is read-only. Mm-hmm. So if you want, it's primarily driven for people who want to, here's my JSON payload, let me create a indexable or view accessible object out of it, and then party on the values. So in this case, we have, you can get call the get properties, pass in the property name, and you have, we have APIs that converts the JSON element, which is what you get, into .NET types, like in this case, double. So what we're doing here is, we go and look at for all this, all the students, get their grades, and once we have the value for that, and convert them to a double. And this is what our application is doing, just summing them up and returning the average.
So these JSON, like these things that you return there, like the JSON element, for example, that's not a class then? That's basically a struct or something?
That's right. So again, emphasis on reducing allocations. Our cursor type that represents each JSON token is a struct. And this is a union type. It represents any JSON token, whether it's an object or array or strings.
Right. And so this way, you can basically get a structured view over the data, but you can't modify it, right? It's read-only, you said.
Right. And I mean, this is something we have feedback for in the past, and I would love to see hear more feedback. People want more read and write capabilities and modify capabilities, and we would consider that in the future as well.
Right. So like, when you say zero allocations, this is literally like no matter how large the file is, you literally allocate nothing. Because I mean, at some point, there needs to be some sort of index that is being built. Right.
So because we use the array pool under the covers, effectively, if your payload is less than a megabyte, it doesn't allocate. After that, we start hitting the limitation of the array pool and start allocating.
So the array pool like technically allocates, but the idea is it's an amortized cost.
That's
so when you have like millions of requests, like they don't grow linearly, right? They basically stay within whatever the pool can handle.
Yes.
And when things that get larger than 1 megabyte, we no longer allocate on the pool. Is that the idea?
Yeah. So the pool under the covers effectively starts allocating on as DC arrays. But even then, our allocation size is proportional to the JSON payload, mm-hmm. and rather than it being 5 or 10x, which would be required if you had built up a tree or a dictionary under the covers.
That's cool stuff.
Yep. Now, going back to the lower level APIs, which are the reader and writer. So we have the lower level reader and writer APIs. For example, we have the JSON writer. Now, again, it works natively on UTF-8, mm-hmm. so therefore we call it UTF-8 JSON writer. And this has very similar APIs that you're probably used to, like write or start object, write string, write number, et cetera. It takes in a stream, if you want to write to a stream, like a memory stream in this case. It also takes in an iBuffer writer, which is a new interface that we added in 2.1. Mm-hmm. So if you want more buffer management and more buffer management control, you would instantiate a new iBuffer writer and pass that in. On the read side, we have a UTF-8 JSON reader. And this takes UTF-8 data as a span of byte. And this also similar, the code is similar to what you write with JSON.NET, which is you have a reader loop with a switch for token types.
Right.
Our token types might be slightly different, but generally it's you go through the reader loop and you switch on whether it's a property name, string, et cetera. Now I want to showcase this, just have it run and see what it looks like. So first is the display for writer. We have indented it, so it looks like that. Let me go back to what the writer code looks like. And again, this writer is disposable, so you want to make sure that you're using. And let's say first we have written this data. You want to read it. And that would look as follows. So if you want to take a look, it's like we have the first token. It's a forward-only reader, so mm-hmm. it goes token by token. You have the start object, then you get the property name, which is date. Then you get the string, which is the value, followed by the temp number and then an object. And this helps users to be able to read really large payloads because the reader has no allocations and just keeps reading forward.
Right. So when you say perf is better, so can we actually substantiate this claim? Because otherwise it's just this, oh, we are faster by how much?
Like,
are we 2x faster? Are we 100x faster?
Right.
Like what does it actually mean?
So one thing that we do a lot in our team is we do a lot of perf testing. And a lot of the perf testing, I mean, it's all on GitHub. So I want to showcase a PR that we have that I added perf tests for serialization and deserialization for various models that we found commonly in web apps. And if you notice here, like most of the cases, we are roughly 2x faster than, for example, in deserialization from JSON.NET. And when you compare the allocations, we are we have less allocations as well. Now, in this case, we are allocating because we have to allocate the actual object at the end.
Right.
But in general, like same here, we have different models. This takes 1.7 microseconds, and JSON.NET would end up taking almost two times the cost. And here you can see the allocation difference show up. Similarly, on the serialization side, we have some of the models. If you want to serialize, we are 1.5 to 2x faster there as well.
Right.
And again, emphasis on lower allocations.
So these numbers seem really small. Like, I mean, microseconds is not something that most people like measure in their day-to-day life.
Right.
So why does this matter if you're like 2x as fast for like microseconds?
Right. So I mean, this goes back to working with ASP.NET. And what we have seen is in their MVC processing, they have gain up to a 20% throughput end-to-end. And I have some numbers to share for that as well. So if we take a look at using System.Text.Json in ASP.NET, for the larger the payload, the higher the gain for performance. So requests per second went up from 7,000 with using JSON.NET to over 16,000.
Right.
And we have smaller memory footprint as well. So even in the end-to-end, some of the higher level end-to-end scenarios, in ASP.NET, in MVC, in SignalR, we see substantial performance gains because of this.
Yeah, I mean, if you like, I think if you have a partner like Bing, for example, that does that, right? And if you imagine you have like millions of requests or, you know, machines in the cloud that you have to support in order to get a number of, you know, throughput per second.
Right.
If you can save 20% of your machines, that is actually money you can measure, right?
That's
because
right.
You pay for your compute in the cloud.
Exactly.
It's no longer free, right? Your hardware is not free in that model.
That's right.
That is super cool. So, like, one thing that I would like to ask you too is, like, where can people give feedback? Like, how can they engage with us?
Right. So, I think the best part, since we are in preview right now, the best avenue for feedback is Loggerbug and CoreFX.
Right.
So, CoreFX, you can go to the GitHub repo, .NET CoreFX, and file new issue.
That's also where the source code is for it.
That's exactly where the source code is, and you can find all sorts of documentation and porting guides and things like that if you would look for System.Text.Json. It contains our roadmap, our design goals, and so this is where we are tracking a lot of the feature requests, a lot of the issues that might come up. And since it's a preview, I actually really want people to try this out and give us feedback so that we can, you know, make the product more stable and leverage the scenarios that people have.
Yeah, in fact, I think today, I mean, by the time this video is going live, it's probably no longer today, it's probably more like last week. But today, preview 6 shipped.
That's right.
And in preview 6, that's when MVC, I think, switched to use our serializer by default. I think in preview 5, it was still JSON, not if I remember correctly.
Right.
And so the idea is that, people just upgrade to in preview 6, take the existing ASP.NET apps, just let them serialize and see what no longer works.
That's right.
Ideally, everything should work, but
yes.
I think that's overly optimistic, given that we don't have the exact same feature set.
And again, if some of the scenarios that don't work, it's not like we would definitely take them in for a future release, which is what we're actually aiming for as well. If you were to go to .NET Core download link, and you'll be able to see the preview 6 live, you can go and grab that from there. And that's the first step that you would want to do to try it out. And if you're also, by the way, if you're running ASP.NET web apps that are on full framework, you can reference the System.Text.Json NuGet package, which is NextGen 2.0 compatible.
So that means I can reference from any platform that is implementing .NET Standard 2.0,
which is
.NET framework. I think we say 4.6.1, practically it's 4.7.2, I think, due to issues that we had. But basically, the library can be used by anybody. Do we get the same perf gain everywhere, or is it just
core? So the performance gains are mainly higher on core,
mm-hmm.
Because that's what we primarily optimize for. And because that's all of the primitives, unlike primitives like UTF-8 parser, span, et cetera, are faster on core.
Right.
But the design algorithm remains the same across both implementations.
Right.
So things like the JSON document not allocating should work on both full framework and core.
That is awesome. So if you like this, go give us feedback, download the previews, play with the bits, go to GitHub, file issues, talk to us. We'd like to hear from you, whether you like it or whether you don't like it, especially when you don't like it, we want to hear from you.